Welcome to Spiritual Spectrum. We're pleased to be in your living room tonight, or wherever it is you happen to be viewing this show, to discuss with you a subject that we've entitled Sexual Ethics for Singles. As a clergyman, that's surely one of the hottest issues going, and if we brought it up around the church house, there would be people who would be angered by any discussion that moved away from, you know, what has been a time-honored, understood moral ethic of Christendom, and I would dare say of most of the mainline faiths in our world, and that is the thou shalt not kind of thing. Karen Labatt, in an article entitled Appropriate Vulnerability, A Sex Ethic for Singles, now, I like what she does with this because she takes us back through some of the kinds of stuff where we have been, and I want to spend just a couple minutes setting this up with you, and then just see where we want to go with this as we talk about, you know, how does one in our time, this is really the root issue, come up with some kind of a sexual ethic, to do or not to do, to be or not to be, and all of those great questions. I love this article of hers because when she talks about single sexuality, she says that we come into this world single and we go out single, and we spend a lot of time here in between. But there has been a presupposition in the sociology of our world that if people are going, now this used to be the presupposition, that if people are going to express themselves or be active sexually, that they will, of course, do it within marriage. We've even had a term, marital sex and premarital sex. And so times have changed when the great sexual revolution came, and I've been around long enough to have remembered that very, very well, where we went from the thou shalt not generation to almost the thou shalt generation. It was almost as if there were nothing but restraints, and suddenly in the 60s there was this great opening up, and we did not have those kinds of restraints anymore. It was back in those days that a guy named Fletcher wrote a book called Situation Ethics that really made the rounds in the church, and it was very controversial because Fletcher dared to suggest that people would make decisions based on some kind of a loving, responsible look at life and a determination and behavior that was based on two things, that it would be loving, but it would be responsible. Very concerned about the other party, always. So, you know, we kind of have come from that. I love this little quote that comes out of Fletcher's book, which kind of outlines what the ethic used to be like. Jennifer, probably before your day, but it was like this. There was a young lady named Wild who kept herself quite undefiled by thinking of Jesus and social diseases and fear of having a child. Now, when I was young, that was kind of it, you know, and it worked for a lot of people. It worked for me, basically. I stayed out of big, bad trouble with that kind of an ethic. But at my point in life, I look back on that with a certain amount of chagrin. That was nonsense. Humans are capable of a lot more than that. So that's what we're going to try to talk about tonight, and I have the sense that we probably will do this. Before we go any farther into this, I want to welcome you two to this show tonight. Jennifer Baker, tell us a bit about yourself and why you decided, maybe even why you decided to do this tonight. I didn't ask you that.
Well, my name is Jennifer Baker. I'm a Colorado resident, originally from the western slope of Colorado. I go to school in Denver now as a college student, and I basically got coerced to come on, but it seemed like a challenge, and I felt like I should tell the way I feel.
Great. And you are a single young woman.
Yes.
Which helps give us some credibility tonight, because we're going to hear from a woman who's a student and single, and I'm glad you got coerced into doing this. I hope that it was a gentle, loving kind of coercion. Reverend Rob Manzinger over here is a longtime colleague of mine. Rob, introduce yourself to the group tonight and tell us who you are.
Well, my name is Rob Manzinger. I'm originally from Philadelphia and attended college and seminary in Penn State and Eastern Baptist Theological Seminary, the same school that Reverend Taylor went to. And I've been a university instructor for the last 5 years here in Colorado at DU and CSU and Red Rocks, and just made the rounds here. And I'm a surprise guest tonight because we didn't want Mel to know that someone from his same church was going to be showing up, and so.
I was truly surprised, and I should say thrilled, to run into you in the hall out there and to know that we were going to do this. So if you were the one who coerced Jennifer, good work. It's one of the best things you've done in recent memory, and I'm glad to be on this show with both of you. Now, I want to come back to this article that I'm kind of using as a setup, and then quickly we'll get into it. So if the little ditty about Miss Wilde, which I read you, is on the one side of it, it's sort of the great thou shalt not ethic that our society used to know. The other side of it can be characterized by this particular statement that comes out of a comic strip, Kathy. And she says, she's getting ready to go out on a date, and she reflects, I'm wearing the heirloom lace of my grandmother's generation with the conscience of my mother's generation, coping with the morals of my generation. No matter what I do tonight, I'm going to offend myself. I liked that article because it talks about the kind of quagmire that we get into once we begin to even act as if there is any option in our life other than marital sex. Now, I hope that what we're going to be able to talk about here tonight is as if there is some other kind of option which is not straight from some lower region, but that has to do with human beings functioning at their very, very best. So, with having said that much, where would you like to jump in on this thing? Rob, you look like you're ready to say something over there, hopefully profound.
Well, let's go back to your little ditty. Was that by Joseph Fletcher? Was that in Joseph Fletcher's
book? It was just
book?
In his book.
In his books. I couldn't...
It's a cutesy that he's quoting from someone.
Okay.
A limerick.
Well, a lot has changed. I mean, Fletcher wrote Situation Ethics in 63. And probably the world as we know it, obviously, since 63 has changed. And, say, two millennia preceding that, you know, marriages were based on two issues. First, you've got property, and secondly, you've got procreation. Now marriages take a whole different scenario. You know, they're based on mutual fulfillment. And part of the mutual fulfillment ideal is sexuality. Now, that brings up a second issue. You know, when you go back and you read your Shakespeare and read Romeo and Juliet, well, gee, Romeo is 15 and Juliet's 13. Obviously, when they're entering the years of sexual maturation, the years of marriage weren't too far along. You know, they were coming right along behind that. Now we're reaching a period where people are encouraged to wait 5-10 years, you know, after they've already reached, you know, sexual maturation. They're told they need to wait till their mid or late 20s before they get married. So we're into a whole different world than that limerick is in. So I thought I'd just throw that out there for starters.
The world has changed in the last 30 years or so, is what you've just said. And you know, it's true. Drastically. Of course, with the deferred time for marriage, I mean careers, working, trying to get some small amount of money together to make it all possible. Yeah, there is all of this glandular activity in the humanoid, and yeah, so what do you do with all of that in the meanwhile? Jennifer, you want to say anything? You want to hop into this yet?
Well, I think part of waiting until you're older to get married, part of it has to do with the feminist movement as far as women go. You're supposed to assert yourself as a person, as a woman, as an individual in your career, in your life with other people. And I think it's important for everyone to come into themselves and understand themselves before they try to understand and support another person. And I think it's that way through all types of marriage, and I think that's the way it should be. And I think waiting until you're older to get married is important. But I don't think necessarily waiting, since sex is a very important part of marriage today, I think waiting for sex until marriage maybe is not the best or the way that it's done.
So, yeah, we would agree with you. I mean, Rob's waiting very carefully as he goes through life with this whole business of marriage and doesn't certainly want to rush it. And, you know, I was 25 when, and at my age, that was pretty right. Back in the 50s, I mean, gee, to get to that point and still be single, all of my friends were married several years before me. I really thought I knew what I was doing, and it turns out I did not, and made a very rash mistake in spite of all of my best judgments in my first marriage. So, yeah, I couldn't agree with you more. I think that's very, very important, that people should not get married until they're really ready to know who they are and have some measure of ability to support and sustain themselves. So we've come a long way from the days of dirt farming where marriage was a way of sustaining life and raising children, and the children became economic units to help produce on the farm. I mean, we're in a totally different world now where people wait a lot longer to do the thing called marriage, and where sexual expression or sexual activity, you know, happens early on, as what, junior high school for some people? Okay, but certainly we can say that young people today, the overwhelming statistics, everything that I read, it seems to indicate that they're sexually active and by the time they're out of high school and in their early 20s, to some, whatever sexually active means, some sexual experience with members of the opposite sex. And at least at this point, I just talked about another definition of expressing oneself sexually. And, you know, I think what I'd like to do is delimit our discussion tonight, if we can, to heterosexual relationships and leave same-sex discussion out of this, if we can. That's another whole dynamic field, but it certainly is a part of sexual expression. Well, I'll see where we go with that. We're probably going to be better off if we manage to do that tonight or today. But the question is that I'm concerned about, and I hope that we're going to be able to address this. So how do we arrive at some kind of an ethic, some kind of a way for determining how, when, and where we will express ourselves or be active sexually, and know that we have somehow been consistent with all of the highest and best rules that are embedded within our culture and inside of us, because each of us has some kind of an inner moral mechanism, a guidance system. How do we arrive at this kind of an ethic? If the thou shalt not ethic really has serious lacks, but the thou shalt ethic is almost too whimsical. I mean, I want to, first of all, let's talk about that first of all. I've made an assumption there that you may or may not agree with. How do you feel about the thou shalt not or the thou shalt kind of thing? Go for it.
Well, you sort of delineated the two extremes of the spectrum. You know,
right.
You've got thou shalt, you've got you're endorsing promiscuity and these sorts of things, then you've got the thou shalt not, which says no under all circumstances.
Right.
Now, it's sort of interesting that you wanted to limit the discussion to heterosexuality, and Mal, I wouldn't have been invited on this show if I wasn't, you know, supposed to be, you know, like a gadfly. And so I'm going to reintroduce the homosexual issue briefly here.
Okay.
Just briefly, because, you know, once you say thou shalt not, and you, which has been the church's tradition,
right,
you know, over you know, a long period of time, you've already shut the door to homosexuality. Now, you know, the discussion doesn't necessarily limit itself to the church, but if you say thou shalt not, or premarital sex, or sex outside the boundaries of marriage, you've already eliminated a whole population group. And so I want to, you know, just bring them back in for the discussion briefly, just to say, well, that's just one extreme. The thou shalt not. And I think the church needs to really examine its position in the light of not only homosexuality, but in the light of divorce. I mean, we've got, you know, a large divorce rate right now.
Right.
And we've also got, as we've discussed earlier, the fact that people are waiting longer to get married. And ironically, at the elder end of the spectrum, we've got a lot of elder women who have, their husbands have passed away. And what, you know, what sort of sexual ethics should they have? So I think we've got a whole range of issues that fall in between thou shalt not and thou shalt with everyone who just happens along.
Agreed. And I want to explain myself why I tried to delimit this discussion to heterosexual behavior. It's just because in our world today, the whole discussion of homosexuality almost launches us into another orbit. You know me well enough to know that I have no hang-ups in discussing that. I mean, and I agree pretty much with what I've heard you just say. And the church has done some very bad things, I think, to human beings by putting such a restricted kind of a cage around who we are as human beings and our ability to express ourselves sexually. So, but I just thought it might save us some ground and keep us more focused on the subject which we tried to put out here tonight, which is how do we develop an ethic for single sex, or for single people to sexually express themselves, recognizing, of course, that single people can be heterosexual, homosexual. Okay. So we can go any way you want with that. Maybe that's a bad suggestion to delimit it. You've already responded to that, Rob, you agree that the... that those two extremes probably are out of the picture. And am I hearing you say then that we need to find some kind of a middle ground?
Exactly.
All right. Now, Jennifer, what about you? You pretty much agree?
Agree that there needs to be a middle ground. And I think the first part of finding the middle ground is to completely rule out the premarital sex, marital sex part of it. Not put it in terms of marriage at all, but rather in terms of responsibility and maturity. You know, in faced with the problems with society as far as disease, pregnancy, and the things that go on, you have to deal with those issues, but you have to deal with them outside marriage and not put it in terms of marriage at all.
So, just say why, or comment, if you will, why not use those traditional boundaries within marriage, marital sex?
Well, if you put it in terms of an agnostic point of view, for people who are not in the what you call traditional sect, who are not of the Christian doctrine or other religious doctrines, that would automatically rule them out by putting it into a marriage boundary.
Okay.
When they unify in a marriage type relationship, common law or whatever it may be, they don't do it in the eyes of God. And I think it's important to recognize people who are not religious as it's defined.
Because that's a big part of our population.
It's an extremely huge part.
Yeah, even though all the polls talk about what great believers Americans are. I mean, believe in God, believe in Jesus, believe in the Bible literally. For goodness sakes, it scares me to death to read some 70% of Americans claim that they believe in the Bible literally. I can't possibly understand what that is.
I think right now Americans are trying to learn to believe in themselves, and I think that's the most important thing.
And a lot of Americans in that journey are agnostic.
Yes.
About a whole lot of stuff, particularly, shall we say, institutional religion, which kind of covers it all. Okay. Yeah, I think that's a fair statement. So we leave the discussion of marital sex aside, because that's bound so with tradition. But I would think that we ought to talk about the problems that maybe there's a problem with defining it. I mean, even if it didn't even have religious overtones. I mean, have we not already said that just to talk about sex within marital relationships only is too restrictive? I mean, is that what I'm getting the feeling? I mean, that's what you two are saying.
Well, it indicates that sex can only be fulfilling within a marital relationship. And obviously, we're entering an era where people are entertaining lawsuits against their spouse because they're forcibly trying to have sex with them. And, you know, sex, if it has to be mutually fulfilling, has to mean there are two parties who are mutually consenting. And just because you're married doesn't mean that two parties are always willing and able at any particular point. And I think that's part of the problem in saying right away from the get-go that the only way you can have a satisfying sexual life is that you're married.
Let's just say, has institutional religion been wrong about this for all these years, or has the context of modern life moved to such a new arena that it's passed that kind of an ethic by?
Well, Nancy Reagan was wrong, Mel. I mean, she and Ronnie said, just say no, but, you know, maybe that worked for them, but I'm not sure it works for the rest of us.
Well, okay, that was a simplistic answer to the drug problem. Just say no, but you're
no,
saying...
No, but it's also to the sexuality problem. There's a movement now that's a Just Say No celibacy movement where this summer they're going to march in July.
Right.
200,000 people who have chosen celibacy as high school students, and that's their path, and perhaps that's right for them. But just to impose that particular Just Say No ethic on the rest of us it leaves a lot to be desired.
And for our purposes tonight, what I would love for us to come up with, if it's possible, by the time we end this our time together, is to have some kind of a look at, well, this is how we think we ought to go about doing this. This is what I really would like to see if we could come up with. And so far, we've got some things out on the table in terms of where especially you two feel, and I think I'm adding my own in here, but we really haven't come out with it yet and said, well, what will this ethical apparatus, this moral decision-making unit, David Reisman once said in a book, The Lonely Crowd, this inner gyroscope, you know, that'll give us a sense of balance no matter how rough the way is. You know, what is this going to look like? I mean, what's it going to take to do this? So what are some of the ingredients then, if we're going to talk about the fact that it is possible right here in a safe for singles, well, it's happening, but we're talking within a moral arena. So it's possible for singles to express themselves sexually outside of marriage, and if that's the case, on what kind of a basis do we say that, do we come up with some kind of guidelines for this? I mean, a person grows up, they've got to get to the place, Jennifer, where you are, where they beginning to talk like what I'm hearing you talk about, words like responsibility, accountability. I think I heard that. What is it? What are the ingredients of this ethic?
I think that's a good place to start.
I think it's important that you be responsible for your actions, that you remember that, as the laws of physics say, each action has an equal and opposite reaction. And it's important to realize that. It's important to realize that if you are engaging in sex, from a woman's point of view, you can not only contract diseases, which may be fatal or debilitating, but you can also become pregnant. And I know the point I am in my life, being pregnant or having a disease certainly would not fit well into my lifestyle. And I don't really look forward to having anything like that happen anytime soon. So I think it's important to take responsibility and to think responsibly when you're engaging in sex or considering engaging in sexual activities. And I think more than a matter of morality today, I've seen sex as being, and I've seen people viewing sex as more of a fact-based decision. Can I get a disease from this person? Is the protection I'm using going to protect me? Things like that. It's more based on that than a moral decision on the part of the individual.
So it's like a functional
sex has
view.
Become pretty much an accepted day-to-day occurrence, especially in the college where I am at. Sex is to be expected for most people who go to a frat party or things like that. It's the natural way of things, so it seems. And you can only hope that those people are being responsible and mature in their decisions, but I think it's more based on a fact basis than it is a moral decision.
So Jennifer's making a distinction, if I'm hearing you right. Let me make sure I'm getting this. Like, the morality of the whole thing gets at more an inner mechanism of all the values that I hold and the things I hope for myself in life, and being accountable and responsible to myself, for starters, let alone, we haven't talked about humankind in general, as opposed to just what's the cost going to be here. I mean, how risky is this? Can I go out and have a good one tonight? Can I get a good lay tonight or whatever without getting any difficulty, getting diseased or anything of the kind? And so you're making a separation between a value structure, morality,
I think,
and
that's
functionality.
I think that's the way it's being viewed by people of my generation.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's good to hear, and shocking in a way, but yeah, that's good to hear. I want to hear more about that. Yeah, Rob.
Well, I can't speak for your generation, obviously, but I'm going to take a little deviance of opinion here and be a gadfly, since I was a gadfly with Mel.
Just say it. Go ahead.
This distinction between fact and value, I'm not really convinced that one ought to base a sexual ethic on fear. Now, I know we live in an age of diseases and all that, but before AIDS, there was herpes. Before herpes, there was syphilis and gonorrhea. I mean, we've got a whole lineage of diseases. And I'm not saying one ought not be responsible, but I mean, if we're talking about where do you begin a sexual ethic, I don't think you ought to begin with fear. I think you need to begin with what you said before, with taking responsibility for your actions. I'm going to take the moral side in sense and saying that you need some sort of care and concern for the person that you're with. And then coupled with that, then you can bring in the so-called fact-based things. But for so long, sex, not only in religious traditions, but in non-religious traditions, is seen as unclean. We live in a politically correct age. If a man tells a woman, "I like your hair," that's construed as a sexual comment. That's a fact-based thing. And I'm not sure that that's, that's where we ought to be right now. We ought to be able to say, I care about you as a person, and this is a morally based judgment, rather than some sort of fact-based thing that we're going to operate out of fear of either getting a disease or litigation or something on those grounds.
I'm not necessarily saying that facts should be the main ethic. I'm saying that that definitely plays a part in the way people have encountered sex as it is today.
Yeah, the way what governs their behavior. I'm hearing her say that this is the way a lot of people function. I didn't hear you say that's the way you function, but I heard you describing your generation, especially a lot of peers around school. Yeah, but Rob does bring us back to focus on the fact that, in fact, that becomes a thou shalt not. That's a return to almost, to that very old ethic that we kind of have ruled out here by saying that probably is a dysfunctional ethic in our own time. And probably always should have been. I look back on it, by the way, it did serve to keep me out of trouble. and never getting a woman pregnant or anything of the kind. I mean, it got me launched into life without those kinds of difficulties. But as I look back on it, I think it is not based on, which is what you're just saying, on the highest and best stuff of which human beings are capable of is moral decision makers. Yeah, you know, that's my beef with it, and that's, I think, what I hear you focusing on as you're commenting about these people that she's describing.
Yeah, and then if people tell sexual jokes now, I mean, back 30 years ago or 100 years ago, they were called unclean. We tell a sexual joke, and it's considered unclean. Dirty.
Dirty story.
Dirty story, which gives you the implication that sex is dirty. And, you know, I don't think we've still have not overcome that in these enlightened 1990s. Sex is still perceived to be dirty.
Well, I think one of the reasons that it is perceived to be dirty is because of the way a majority of the population, I feel as a majority, engages in sex. I think it is more than as a matter of caring about the other person. It is more of an impulsive reaction to your body, at least in my age group, and what I've seen. It's an impulsive reaction of the body. This is what I want to do right now. Is it safe? Okay, maybe it is. Let's go for it. And so it's more of people are learning to take more responsibility for their actions out of fear than they are for morality and care for the other person.
Yeah, and if people are concerned about where they're headed in life enough to not want to get HIV, herpes is a big enough problem. HIV will kill you. Herpes just makes life miserable, depending on the degree of symptomatic behavior. But there's surely more to us than that, is what I hear you keep saying. And it's almost like you have a lament built into this kind of thing.
I think it's very sad. And I think morality and caring about someone should be a part of it. I think that if you're going to be having sexual relationships, they should be monogamous with one partner. And you know, perhaps after a few months or a few years, that partner may change. Because at this point in my life, I haven't found anyone I want to spend the rest of my life with, and I'm sure a lot of people my age have not. But for the moment, they might think they have, and they might want to engage in sexual activity, which they may morally be moral about it. They may care about the person, take precautions, be responsible out of care for the other person and for themselves. But, and I think that's a very important thing. I think that's the way it should be, that they should be mature enough to deal with the situation and responsible enough to deal with the situation. But sadly, that's not what's happening most of the time.
All right. Let me just say to you that with the three of us sitting here, I mean, you're a university student. We've been through a lot of school, graduate school, and you're in the throes of working on your PhD dissertation even now, and I have a doctorate from a seminary, and we have obviously benefited from some of what our culture would say the best of what America has to offer people who grew up in our society, and maybe have the apparatus built in us through family upbringing and other kinds of contextual environmental stuff that's molded us to talk like this, but. So one of the things we did not limit when we began, we sort of just talked about, I said to you, do you think we can come up with some kind of an ethic for singles with regard to expression of their sexuality or non-expression of would be the other side of that? But I'm aware as I've listened to us talk and as I listen to you express yourself that we could go out and find some other single persons in your age group who wouldn't begin to know how even to talk like I'm hearing you talk because they haven't been raised like this. They don't have this kind of inner mechanism to think like this and to make these kinds of decisions. And one of the big problems in our world today is that whole segment of society that's continuing to you know express themselves sexually, I think, out of the worst side of you know, just maybe it's the one comfort that they have. Or some kind of fun, or it's a right that they've got. It could be, who knows what it's all about, but we're getting a lot of children from, I think, the opposite side of the, I would want to say, the irresponsible sexual behavior, and that's becoming a big problem of our culture. And I don't know what we do about that, because what we're talking about sounds like the way, for example, we might try to raise our children. If we were all to be classroom teachers, we might try to inculcate this kind of thing that we're working toward, and I'm loving your talk about responsible behavior, because all behavior has consequences, and I've got to be prepared to deal with the consequences of my behavior.
Well, I think it's also important to realize that responsibility does not come after the fact. The responsibility I'm talking about is not when the woman you're engaging with in sexual activity has had her baby and you decide to marry her, because in a lot of cases, I think that's not a good idea. I think that if the two parties don't love each other and can't raise a child in a family of love, then they shouldn't get married. And the child might be better off in a single home. I think the responsibility needs to take place before anyone engages in sexual activity. You need to take precautions for birth control. You need to take precautions to protect from diseases. And if you care enough about the other person, then you will do that. But there's a difference here. There's the ethic as it should be, and there's the ethic or just the way things are. And there's a huge distinction between the two.
So we're talking on the one hand about an ideal here, and you have fingered this already in talking about peer behavior as you experience it in the university setting. We're talking about an ideal, and on the other hand, we're talking about actuality in terms of how, you know, what's out there in the streets or in our life experience. This is not an easy subject. But let's keep talking about our ideal, and then I don't know where we go from there, except that I know that if the three of us could arrive at an ideal that we were somewhat comfortable with, or at least know where we are. Maybe it's going to be three ideals. At least we know what to do with ourselves. I mean, and that's a start, you know, in making society what it ought to be. So what are the ingredients going to be? So far, I'm hearing you've got to be in charge of yourself, and you've got to be responsible about your behavior and the consequences of it, and that's got to be up front. You're saying.
Yes.
Before there is any sexual activity.
Yeah.
Okay. I like the sound of that. You're not going to quibble over that, are you, Professor?
No, I'd probably place a couple other things up there on that priority list.
Do it.
One would be that I've already mentioned the idea that sex is good and it's healthy. It's a normal part of human functioning. It's a normal part of expression of care and concern for another person that you're in love with. And so I would just say sex is healthy. Now, obviously,
I agree with that.
One need to have precautions. Now, the second thing, which we haven't talked about yet, and it's not only a part of our ideals, but I think ought to be a part of our operational procedure with other human beings, is the notion that when we're engaged in sexual behavior with someone, we treat them as a person and not as a thing. I think we can look at our historic texts in the Western world. Look at the Bible. Paul says, you know, you shouldn't fornicate, basically saying don't treat the other person as a thing. Plato in the Phaedrus says the same thing about heterosexual and homosexual behavior. If you're going to treat the other person as a thing, as a self-indulgent means to get satisfaction without any care and concern for them, then there's something wrong with that. And so I would say if we treat other people as persons and not as things or as objects, then I think that's another part of any sexual ethic.
Now, in the very beginning, I talked about...
I think that maturity is that's part of being a mature person, if you're engaging in sex, is to recognize the other person, the other partner, as a person as well.
Mm-hmm. The value. Give them value.
Yes.
And dignity and respect. Yeah, this article to which I referred and quoted from briefly by Karen Labatt gets into this whole arena in trying to develop an ethic for singles around the expression of their sexuality. And she takes this to a very interesting level. Let me see if I can, in capsule form, say this and see what you think of this. So I understand her. She talks about the fact that she does get to the place where it's time for us to affirm, and Rob, you said this a couple of times, mm-hmm. within the Christian tradition, we have, I think, gone a long way toward overcoming the negative cast or pale that's been cast over our sexuality, and you know, affirming the fact that you know this apparatus that we've got is wonderful. I love to think about who in the world and what God must be, he, she, to have concocted us like we are. And there have been a lot of interesting kinds of things written about the humor of God, you know, with regard to humans and sexual act and all this kind of thing. But it's a wonderful area to wonder about. But at least within the branch of Christendom that I'm conversant with, you know, I like the literature that's very affirming, as Robin said. We've moved past this. And we can even go back to our roots, whether it's in Genesis, where the man and the woman were naked and they felt no shame. They were totally vulnerable to each other and felt no shame. Or you're reading in the Song of Songs, which really has a lot of positive stuff to say about passionate, sensual sex, which nobody ever talked about when I was growing up, but it was there right in the middle, right in the middle of our Bible. There's a lot to be said for that. Okay. Karen talks about the fact that if we're going to develop an ethic around this, it gets at some of the issues that I hear you talking about now. It's that when people are appropriately expressing themselves sexually, they become totally vulnerable to each other. And that in this vulnerable state, it's the ultimate denuding. People usually strip down, though not always, for sex, but for the sexual union or act. But when you're bare naked with another person, I mean, there is nothing to hide there. I mean, it is a moment of total vulnerability, and it is a place where if a person is into power trips, power and control, suddenly the vulnerability of the other partner is not going to be respected, and so you have all this domestic violence where one partner demands, usually the male because he's bigger and stronger physically, of the woman, but not always is that the case, and we still smile about that kind of stuff, though it's not funny. But there's something about her whole thesis about being vulnerable and understanding how vulnerable we are and treating each other's vulnerability with great love and respect and care that as Karen develops this article, she talks about developing a sexual ethic along this line. It's just a handle. It's another way of getting at the same kind of thing that Karen is talking about, mutual respect and all of that. I don't know. What does that sound like? Is that...
Well, it sounds like what Jennifer was talking about mutual respect, but also maturity. We're able to embrace the other's feelings and thoughts and concerns. There's a theologian who died, I guess, about 15 years ago, Bernard Loomer, but he talked about how we have the capacity for greater size, meaning we not only have our own feelings and our thoughts, but we have the ability to take in other thoughts or otherness into ourselves. Where we're able to take the other person's feelings and incorporate them and then act in a fashion where not only are you dealing with your own feelings, but in some level, since you can't think or feel for someone else, at least you, to the best of your ability, have been able to take what they've told you and incorporate it. And I think that's a real helpful concept, to be able to not only treat, Jesus' ethic says treat others the way you want to be treated, but part of what I'm writing my dissertation on is treating other people the way that they want to be treated. And I think that's an additional step.
And of course, all of this is assuming that we're dealing with people who are basically emotionally healthy, recognizing that all of us are in some stage of maturation and dealing with some of our own dark side or dysfunctional behavior or whatever. Because, this only reminds me of what an idyllic conversation we're having here. It's a great luxury to try to think about this and talk about, how we can be sexual beings like we are and express all of this in some beautiful, meaningful, thoughtful, caring, loving way. I guess that's what we're saying. But I continue to be struck by what a luxury it is to have this conversation and how many people just don't give a rip about it and are just going for it. By the way, I wanted to come back to something and just get a quick reaction to this. That you did talk about the Just Say No campaign. There, for every action, there's a reaction. You reminded this of this earlier, Jennifer. And so there is the whole thing, the push to go back to celibacy. Stay celibate till marriage. Now, the way I set this up, I talked about the thou shalt not, the thou shalt kind of things as probably being morally bankrupt or not really functional anymore. But there is a return to that in our time. Rob, you kind of touched on that, but we really are getting some feeling about that. Are we prepared to say here tonight that there's no validity for this at all? In other words, that for a person to decide that, for example, to pick up on what you said, Jennifer, that to really be morally responsible with myself and totally... cognizant of what I'm doing with my body and everything, that I will make the decision to stay celibate until I'm married because I think that's the best way, even if I end up 35 and celibate.
Well, of course, it's a personal decision, but I think that part of recognizing ourselves and understanding ourselves and coming to know ourselves is coming to know ourselves as a sexual being.
So experience is...
Not necessarily experience, but understanding that part of yourself. I think if you are forcing yourself into a celibate lifestyle until looking towards some distant day that has no promise of coming and saying, well, I'm going to wait for this person that could be a myth, that I don't think that's right, because I think as your sexual side is oftentimes called your dark side, and I don't see it as a dark side. I see it as an integral part of who we are. And I think when people come into contact with themselves sexually and they recognize who they are in that respect as well as who they are in other respects, I think that's one of the most important parts of growing up and becoming your own person. And I don't think you can truly care about another person and give them what they need until you know what you yourself need. And I think that's important to know sexually as well as spiritually and emotionally.
So if I'm hearing you right, I'm hearing you say that, I mean, I did tuck in the word experiential, but what I think I'm hearing you say is that part of the maturation process of growing up and of getting a grip on oneself, you know, understanding who I am, who we are as persons, necessarily means some kind of experience sexually rather than just holding off and creating some kind of a celibate ideal against the day when finally, you know, the veil will be drawn back and sex will be experienced.
Yeah, I don't think that would be a proper way to come about knowing yourself. And also, you have to bring back in the homosexual question in this, because in most states in the within the United States, same-sex couples cannot be recognized.
Be married, that's right.
And if you rule out that, you know, if you say, well, you can't get married because that's the way things are in this country, then what are they supposed to look forward to as a celibacy thing? They have nothing. And it's often important, you could calculate the number of marriages that have been destroyed by one person within the marriage realizing that sexually they are not meant to be with the opposite sex. And if they find out beforehand who they are sexually as well as who they are, as I said, emotionally and spiritually, I think that's much more important than waiting for that distant day that may never come.
All right. You know, you're making a strong case here. If within the context of this setting, I have no quibble with that. I hear you. The pathos and the tragedy of those folks who are homosexuals and who are denied the privilege of consummating that relationship like a heterosexual couple can, that's one of the ongoing tragedies of our society that needs to be dealt with. And there's no question in my mind about that. I couldn't hear that without saying that. Yeah. It makes me feel sad.
No, Jennifer's raised a number of good points, and I've seen that happen. When I first got out of college, I was attended a church where it was known that the pastor was, or at least the people who claim to know, that he was engaged in homosexual activities. And the pain is that when the ideal is you wait till marriage, what happens was he got married, had several children, and then, I guess, at a certain age decided that he indeed was homosexual and then caused a great deal of travail for his family, you know, because he hadn't had the time to discover himself, at least in a sexual sense.
Of course. To respond to that point which both of you have made now, there's some things we don't learn about ourselves until life goes on. And you know, it's like if we were just trying to discover it all before we made, you know, a particular move. I mean, you know, it just takes time. It's a distillation process. It's being formulated by the river of life or whatever, you know, what metaphor you want to use. And some self-discoveries are just not made. They're like time capsules. It's an artist thing. I keep, you know, there are surprises. On some hands, it's kind of beautiful. By the way, totally off the wall, but different. But I used to remember when I was a kid growing up, we made fun of people who watched. I mean, you know, bird watchers were the butt of a lot of jokes. And guess what? In my 60th year, I love looking at birds. Got my little bird book, you know, which identifies birds, and I'm just fascinated by these things that I used to shoot with a BB gun every chance I got when I was a kid. And I would have never guessed that would change would have come about. So I, you know, life, those kinds of discoveries keep coming along, and I don't know that there's any ultimate. We all three know that there's no ultimate protection against that. Well, you're making some strong case, I guess, for what are we going to say, for living our lives as who we are. We are all created as sexual beings, and sexuality is a state of being. Sexual behavior is activity, and what I'm hearing said here tonight is it's important for the person, the individual, to have the right to make a choice, an informed, hopefully intelligent, reasoned a responsible choice about when and where he or she will express his or herself sexually. That's what I'm hearing us say. Forget all this stuff about there shall be no sex outside of marriage.
Yeah, I think that should just be completely eliminated from the...
Yeah, and I said you do that without any reservation.
I don't.
Did you ever have a reservation about that? Have you come from some distance on that one?
Well, I was raised in a somewhat Christian home. We didn't attend church regularly, and I was told, you know, you should wait until you're married, or at least wait until you're with someone you love, and, you know, give your virginity as a present, that sort of thing. And
did you say that with a smile just now?
I always thought of it as a crock, basically.
Okay.
And I never considered that's, you know, the way it should be. Because I think that if you care enough about the other person to want to find out about yourself, you know, with that other person, because sexuality is an integral part of who we are.
Yes.
And everyone expresses it differently, and I think it's important to get in touch with who you are. And you can't say truly that you know another person until you know, and you can't say that you necessarily love that person, because a lot comes out with the sexual being.
I mean, within the sexual relationship?
Because
it
is a surrender. Desaad would say it's the ultimate surrender, because you're giving over yourself. And when you do that, you open yourself to a lot. You're very vulnerable. You open yourself to a lot. And I think it's important to be doing that with someone that you care about, so you know that they're not going to hurt you. Unfortunately, that's not usually the case. But I think it's definitely a growing process. And I think that it needs to be a growing process, and that it should be experimented with. And I don't think that it should wait until marriage or whatnot, because for a lot of people, marriage is never going to happen. And to push that part of yourself to the wayside and just tell it to stay there and keep on going is, I think, very wrong.
So if I've heard you rightly, I'm not hearing you argue for, and this is more to sharpen up this what we're saying here. I'm not hearing you in any sense arguing for the old term I grew up with, for promiscuous sex or for recreational sex.
No.
You're talking about intimacy and a depth kind of expression of who you are, who we are, as we engage in expressing ourselves sexually with another person who is selected for more than what? Is some kind of body appearance or that the turn on that happens, which is a very powerful thing.
Well,
you haven't said that.
Passion is definitely a part of it. And I think passion should be a part of it. But I think it's also important to care about the other person, because it's not just a growing experience for you as an individual, it's also a growing experience for them. You learn a lot about a person by knowing about their sexuality.
Is there any age? I mean, is there an age of majority here? Can you be 14 years old and be in charge of yourself sexually?
I think some people can. Maturity is not, you can't put a line on it and say, when you get to be this age, you'll be a mature individual and you can make your own decisions. That's just not possible.
Well, up until about 200 years ago, people were getting married at 14 and 15, so.
Of course, different society, you know, arranged marriages and dowries and all that stuff. It was a different world, but they were, that's right.
It depends on your upbringing. It depends on the way you've been raised to know yourself. The experiences you've had, the chances you've had to get to know yourself, depending to see how mature you are.
I just, you know, I want to confess I have a hard time imagining any 14-year-olds I've ever known who are old enough to express anything like what we've been talking about here tonight, which I have a great deal of comfort level. I mean, I'm arriving at that with you all, the kind of responsible sexual expression I'm hearing you talking about. But I really think that young kids just can't have that. They haven't lived long enough. They're not in charge enough of themselves, and there's so many fears, and there's so much drivenness, and there's peer pressure. Kind of a lot. They can't even dress individualistically, you know, and go out of the house with their peers at that age. I mean, there is, to my way of thinking, there is some point at which we emerge more as human beings, and you couldn't have talked like this when you're 14. I don't imagine.
Well, I don't remember how I talked when I was 14, but
well,
But
I love how you're talking tonight, but I'm just thinking that
I've known 14-year-olds who have basically run their family, whose parents worked all the time.
Yeah,
and there was a point in my life when I was a 14-year-old who did all the cooking and cleaning and laundry and took care of my
parent, children, or child.
And that definitely brings in a sense of maturity, but I also think it's important to realize that at that age, as far as your education goes, you haven't necessarily, I know I didn't get a health class until high school. And I think it was either my sophomore or junior year when I got sat down and explained to all the ins and outs of AIDS, diseases, pregnancy. They make you familiar with different contraceptive devices and different ways of birth control. And I think that that's important information for someone to have before they engage in sexual activity.
And at some point, it just doesn't come along well real early on in our culture.
No, it's...
But I hear you.
People tend
to
hold out on the education.
I'm going to be nervous about 14-year-olds, but maybe it's my age. I hear you. You've made a good point again, and there are kids that age that run their families, tragically so, I think. But that's a part of how our world works anymore. Well, how are you feeling? We're getting near the end of our time together. Are we coming anywhere close to coming up with some kind of an expression that we could bottle up and sell if we had to, or we could print on the page and say, hey, we got an ethic for singles in expressing their sexuality?
Well, I think we should all just say no and watch Leave It to Beaver reruns on cable.
Oh, you're terrible. That's awful. That's awful. That prompts me to share with our audience that this is Spiritual Spectrum, and if for any reason they want to communicate with us about this presentation that we have shared with here today, the address to which they can write is 2351 Ogden, Denver, Colorado, 80205. And you are welcome to make that kind of communication and give us some feedback or ask questions about Spiritual Spectrum and the kind of programming that we do on this show. Okay, well, back to kind of getting close to winding up our time together here. Just say no and watch reruns of Leave It to Beaver. Have you ever watched Leave It to Beaver?
Yes, I've watched Leave It to Beaver.
Kind of cute, right? I mean, it's a period piece, but it's definitely different than Beavis and Butthead. Well, I confess I have this slight growing affection for, and that probably says something really warped about my sense of humor and where I'm headed in the world. But those two are kind of curious. I was told by my son I'd better watch this, and I've begun to check in on it. It's kind of fun.
Well, it gives you a pretty good idea of how 12-year-olds are acting.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen Beavis or Butthead have a date? I've never seen them have a date, so maybe they are just saying no.
You and your just say no stuff. I think that, what we've talked about here tonight is one of the toughest subjects going. And to me, it's really important that we develop a sense of responsibility and ability to be in charge of ourselves and who we are. And again, I'm just aware of how hard that is to come, or how difficult a thing that is to come by, depending on one's context and how we grow up and the kinds of values and the kinds of loving care that we get and the input and the ability to express stuff like this until we kind of forge an ideal. And I didn't come by mine overnight. I know that. You didn't either, but I love what I'm hearing you say.
Well, and I think one of Jennifer's points that's very well taken is the maturity point. You know, some people mature early at 14 or 15. Some don't mature until they're 40 or 50. And how can you legislate morality for other people? One of the reasons why I got out of youth ministry is all the parents at one level wanted to have their teenagers make choices for themselves and wanted me to be the enabler of that. But on the other hand, they wanted the just say no stuff because they didn't want to deal with the fact that their teenagers were real live human beings who were going to make real live choices. And they thought the role of a minister was to, guide them morally, which meant keep them out of trouble.
That's right.
And so they wanted you to adopt that role, and on the other hand, they wanted you to enable them to be real human beings. And that sort of tension, I guess, is part of every parent. They don't want anything bad to happen to their children.
And they want the moral agency of the church to help ensure this. When, in fact, I really believe that what the Scripture teaches us, speaking from my own Christian tradition now, is that we are free moral agents. And we need to learn how to exercise that moral agency. That's what I hear us talking about here tonight. And Jennifer, you've given some really good articulation of that. Rob, you had too. I think we have together. We're talking about what it means to be people who are responsible, loving, kind, who are into respecting our fellow human beings across all kinds of boundaries and without any kind of reservation. That's what we're trying to talk about here, is we try to talk about and develop some kind of an ethic for singles, which, by the way, really is an ethic for marriage or for couples or for people who are in in-depth relationships expressing their sexuality, because all of this talk about reverence for human life and responsible behavior, I mean, you can't go home and demand sex from your mate if you're caring about him or her. It just can't, that just can't be. And I'm hearing that talk about that tonight. So what we've said for singles really applies for humans. I see that. Well, any final statement? We're down to the line. But, you know, Jennifer, you want to get in a last word? We'd love to have it.
I just think it's important to define your own morality but through experience, but to make sure that the experiences are responsible.
All right. Well, I couldn't agree more or less, no, more than with what you said, so thanks for that. Well, Reverend Rob, it's been a real pleasure to be in this show with you, surprise guest that you are. I thank you for being here tonight. And Jennifer, you as well. It's been good to be here with you on Spiritual Spectrum, talking about one of life's toughest issues, how to be morally responsible persons and sexually responsible. So see you again sometime along the way, I do hope.
Thank you.
Been fun.
Yeah, it has been fun.